So welcome to everyone for the Sunday service. I'm reading some hymns of praise which are being sung in heaven. It's from Revelations chapter 5. You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, because you were slain, and with your blood you purchased men for God from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. And God Almighty, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, the creator and sustainer of all things, our Savior, we join with the angels and all of creation in exalting you this morning. We lift you up to the highest place. We say that you alone truly are worthy of our praise and worship and thanks. We say, come, Lord Jesus, this morning. Take delight in our worship and be enthroned upon our praises. We pray, Father, that your heart will be delighted with what you see and hear. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you will move among us in your might and power. Come and have your way. We surrender this time into your hands. In Jesus' name, amen.
By the sound of his voice, Father, this morning, Lord, we say, Lord, no matter what is happening around us or within us, no matter what our circumstances, we want to say and acknowledge unequivocally that it is well with our souls, Lord. Because you are with us, Lord. Your eyes are upon each one of us. You know our hearts, you know our circumstances. And you are with us. You have never left or forsaken us. You will never leave or forsake us, Lord. And this morning, Lord, we want to say it is more than enough, because we know, Lord, that you are a good, good Father. And we want to just say, Lord, we love you. We have no words to express our gratitude for who you are and for all that you have done for us. In your most beautiful and precious, precious name, Jesus, we thank you, we worship you, and we pray. Amen.
Lord, we thank you for this place of rest. We thank you for this place where fear can melt away, where anxiety is driven away, where confusion has to hide. It's the place of your presence, Lord. It's your throne of grace. It's in your voice, Lord. It's in the song you sing over us, Father. We ask you, Holy Spirit, to tune our ears, Lord, to that song that you're singing over us even this morning. Lord, we want to hear that voice of truth, that sweet melody of love, Lord, that has the power to dissolve everything negative, Lord, that threatens to consume us, Lord. We want to be found in your embrace this morning, Lord. Resting in the Father's song. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
I just want to read this verse before we sing this next song. The Lord, the King of Israel, is with you. Never again will you fear any harm. The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing.
I have heard so many songs. Listen to the thousand tongues, but there is one that sounds above. Thank you.
Father, just want to say we're just so grateful that we can call you Abba, that you just wait for us in with open arms, Lord, that you actually run toward us, Lord. Just want to thank you, Lord, just for that amazing love that to the world looks reckless, to the world looks crazy. We can't even understand or fathom, Lord, but just want to thank you for that love that embraces us, that surrounds us, that just continues to hold us and comes after us. Thank you that we're never too far gone from you, Lord. Just want to thank you, Father. You are so, so, so good. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Today, Jesus, we thank you that you love us enough to make us go through difficult times so that we may be refined and grow and understand, become stronger We thank you that through that process of refining, you are with us every moment. And so, Lord, we thank you today for all those ways in which you are molding us and teaching us and allowing us, Lord, to suffer, because we know that the end result is that we will come out pure gold. And Lord, that's what we want to be for you today. We want to be pure gold. We want to be just beautiful for you and strong for you and to shine for you, Lord Jesus, to have value and to have meaning in our lives. And Lord, you give us that value and meaning by your presence. And so we thank you just right now, Lord, for your presence here amongst us. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are moving now, that you are working in us and through us and amongst us. Thank you for beautifying this time with your presence, Lord Jesus. We just want to say that we love you more than we can express at this time. Thank you. Amen.
You made this sin. declare that really your glory is so beautiful. And we thank you that we had this absolutely wonderful privilege, Lord, of just coming and being in your holy presence, Lord, sitting at your feet and gazing, Lord, on your beauty. And we just ask this morning, Lord, as Moses did, Lord, if you are pleased with us, Lord, let your presence go with us. Show us your glory. Cause, Lord, all your goodness, Lord, to pass before us this morning. Proclaim, Lord, your name to us, Lord, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God for his presence. Thank you so much, Bangalore girls, for that wonderful time of worship, for inviting his presence and inviting us into his presence. We just continue this time of worship with a time of praise reports. And so feel free to unmute and give God glory for anything that he's done that you're grateful for.
I'd like to start. I think God's goodness has been beyond imaginable for us as a family, as a fellowship, to have Pavani and the children here this entire week, to be able to just spend time with them, all of us together here, to worship with them, just to be together as a family, not just a family, but a spiritual family also together, all of us here. And to be able to just worship together, I think that I didn't realize how much I missed worshiping with people until everybody was here and we could just worship together. So God has been beyond faithful to us. I just want to give thanks for that, and just want to give thanks. Today is my parents' anniversary, and just Mommy was here with us in service, and just to really give thanks for their life together, because we have been so blessed by their marriage and their life together. So
I had a very long and strenuous week with two late evenings that didn't end until about 8:30. So sort of 7 a.m. to 8:30 at night. And I literally had to rely on God for every one of those days to get me through. And he gave me the energy. He gave me clarity. I didn't disgrace myself at our parents' open house. It was really a God thing. And I just saw him working in my life in this week to help me to do everything I had to do. And so I'm so grateful for that. So thank you, Jesus.
I'll go next. Kind of an echo of what Pavana shared. This last week has just been having so many Bombay people in Bangalore. It's been such a delight. Sush had come and she had stayed over, and just having just a brief couple of hours. We had Alpha, so it was after that we could even spend some time together. So just those couple of hours were just so uplifting for my spirit. And then Soups had come for my ladies' fellowship on Sunday, and she shared her testimony, and it was so powerful and incredible. And then she made a meal, because that's her love language, and my love language is eating meals. So it was definitely perfect. And yeah, it's been so good to see Pavs and everybody, you know, just being together. It felt like home, and it's been a great week in some ways. So thank you, Jesus.
I want to thank God for last week's Alpha session. It was the week where it was a session where we invite the Holy Spirit to come. And as it is, my thanks and all are just, I'm so grateful when just a session goes off well, because I'm not tech savvy and I'm managing everything because Uday is not here. And last week really was great amount of pressure, though you know you can't do anything to make the Holy Spirit come or touch people, but still how that session was going to go. And like we've shared before, this is like, I mean, Shanti and I are the older ones, but the rest are all a young team, very enthusiastic, but some of them had not prayed for people before. And we had the session. We've not even asked people yet, which we will today, what they experienced. But we have this time after, which is a debrief. And just from what the team shared, how each one experienced in different ways, whether just the warmth of, you know, the spirit or a feeling of cold, but just each one felt something. And I just wanted to share one thing that really was just so indicative of the beautiful way in which God works. So there was one person on the team who the previous week had said that, you know, just tell me how to stay connected and how do you feel the spirit, and I'm so disconnected. I think the fear was from the place that she's going to be praying for people and she herself is not feeling connected to God or experiencing His presence. So we had the debrief and she shared how, you know, I don't know what's happening. I didn't know what to pray, but this is what I felt. I prayed this for this person. This is what I felt. So one example was she said, for so-and-so, I just kept hearing wisdom, 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 and I prayed wisdom. So multiple things like that were shared. And as she's speaking to me, I see my phone ringing. So I thought, okay, whatever, I'll pick it up because it was somebody from the Alpha course. And it's the boy who this girl has just talked about praying for the gift of wisdom. And he's bawling away like a child. He's saying, auntie, auntie, I've never experienced something like this before. I don't know what happened to me. I felt Holy Spirit. I'm both happy and I'm scared. Will this go away? It was so powerful. And the things that I asked for, you know, I asked for wisdom. That was prayed for me. I wanted this. That was prayed for me. And I just, he needn't have shared that. He did immediately. It came during the debrief time. I could share it. And the girl who prayed started crying because for her, it was, you know, I really felt God's presence. I felt what I should pray. And there were other things like that that happened. But for me, it was just like, God was so sweet to have come, to have touched us, and to have also just reassured the team that He's at work. And it's not about us at all. So I just want to give glory to God.
Yes, Neelam, please go ahead.
Yeah. First of all, I really want to thank each and everybody who has prayed for me. Actually, today's I've been going through very tough days, and Pervin has been there for me, and I know everybody has been really praying for me and my family. Today I feel very happy because I feel like I've come back to school, because I've studied in a convent school. I've grown up listening to carols. And I've loved singing songs like, God is so good, God is so good. I'm very sorry. I wanted to sing this. And songs like, all things bright and beautiful, all creatures great and small. All things wise and wonderful, the good God made them all. And I used to enjoy seeing the skit that used to be played during Christmas. And I fondly remembered all of those memories came back from school today morning. Thank you for making me a part of this, Pervin. I can't thank you enough. Thank you very much. I fondly remember that song. Long time ago in Bethlehem, so the Holy Bible says, Mary's boy child Jesus Christ was born on Christmas Day. Hark now, hear the angels sing. Listen to what they say. That Mary's boy child Jesus Christ was born on Christmas Day. I really want to thank everybody from the bottom of my heart too. And thank you for taking me back to school. Thank you.
So I'm just going to read two messages. Meher says, dearest Neelam, we love you and God loves you too, loves you so much too. He's holding on to you and Jayesh, and he will restore you and bring you out of this valley, and you will sing for joy again. And Jesus is smiling so lovingly over you, Neelam. This is Nisha. You just warmed his heart with your singing. What you have offered him today is more precious than silver and gold. And Meher is saying he's singing, he's hearing you sing and he's singing over you. Carol says, welcome home, Neelam. And Rinel says, Neelam, praise God. We are so blessed to have you with us today. And through this very, very tough time, you are praising Jesus. God's comfort continue to minister to your precious heart. And I'll just read a praise report from Swapu. Swapna says, I would like to thank God for a great week at work. Through the week, he was there protecting me through all the tasks that needed to be done. Praise God.
It also struck me as we were singing, as they sang it as well, that, of course, it was written by somebody who had just lost four of his daughters. And in fact, he wrote those words as he was passing, as he was crossing the sea and passing the place where the ship had sunk, where his four daughters had died, had drowned. And we happened to do that song today. That somehow in all of this, it is well. God is good. And of course, our greatest, most awesome hope is and confidence is that he not just shared our pain, he took our pain on the cross. And so before the sermon, I'd like to move into the time of communion.
trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone. Faultless stand before the throne, Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the stone, he is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior.
Lord, as we come to your table, prepare our hearts in humility. Help us realize the painful death that you suffered in our place. Thank you for paying the price that none of us could, in order to make us right with the Father. For on the night he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread and, after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and having given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Help us to never forget the way you tore the curtain and open the way for us to the Father. Help us to be transformed into your likeness and to be filled with the peace and assurance that your blood, Jesus, truly cleanses away all sin. Thank you. In Jesus' name, Amen.
Just going to read a praise report that Meher has shared for those on Facebook. I have been agonizing and being torn about going to Ria, that's her daughter in America, and being with her and at the same time leaving everything behind, all my responsibilities here. And so I have not been able to fix the time to go, sort of a paralysis. My heart tells me I should go, but practicality is keeping me here. Anyway, Ria has been going through a crisis of sorts and I felt she was heading for a nervous breakdown. She called me and said she's going to come home for just a week as she does not have leave. Very impractical as she will be jet lagged and will need a holiday on going back. But just committed her to God. And now there is a holiday on one Monday in October, and if she gets her leave, she will be able to spend 8 to 9 days here. Maybe God wanted her to come home for refreshing herself, and that is why I could not go. I don't understand what God does or why he blocks certain things, but I know that he does work out all things for good. And so I surrender to his plans and his goodness to us. And Carol says, trusting God for all his purposes for Ria and the entire family Meher.
We thank you, Lord, for your working in our lives. Through the testimonies we've heard, Lord, even through bad times, to know that you are good, that your love endures forever. That we can put our trust and our confidence in you. We thank you, Lord, for the truth and the faithfulness of your word. And we pray, Holy Spirit, that you will bring it alive in our hearts afresh this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. So, you know, there's a familiar story, and it's we find it in three of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, of this rich ruler, or sometimes it says rich young man, whatever he was rich, who comes and tells Jesus, good teacher, what must I do to have eternal life, effectively to be saved? And Jesus says, you know the commandments, and he rattles off some commandments, and that man says, I've done all of these things since I was a child. And it says, Jesus looked at him and loved him and says, one thing you lack, go sell all your possessions, give them to the poor, and then come follow me. And it says that the rich young man or the rich ruler, he went away very sad because he was very rich. And I just want to use this story as a springboard to understand. It's an illustration of what I want to share today. You see, the young man, in all of his enthusiasm and desire, he came looking for a savior, but he encountered the Lord. And he wanted a savior. He didn't want a Lord. And to me, that comes very clearly in a passage in Revelation. And so today's lesson is called The Lion and the Lamb, or sermon rather. And it comes from this passage where it says, and this is a revelation that John is getting of heaven. It says, then one of the elders said to me, do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the root of David, has triumphed. He is able to open the scroll and its seven seals. Then I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain, standing in the center of the throne, encircled by the four living creatures and the elders. So the elder tells John, he says, see the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And when John looks, he sees a lamb. You see, both are pictures of Jesus. Jesus is the Lion of Judah. Jesus is the Lamb of God. In fact, in John's Gospel, when John the Baptist introduces Jesus to his disciples, he says, look, the Lamb of God. And today what I want to do is I want to just compare these two pictures. They're of the same person, of course. They're both of Jesus, but often relating to the lamb is different from relating to the lion. I mean, that's quite obvious. You see, you look at a lamb and it's all cuddly and you want to cuddle it and things like that. You look at a lion, there's no cuddling taking place. Okay, you're more likely to run away from a lion. Or look at it from a distance and say, wow, awesome. Okay, so I want to look at the Lamb of God and the Lion of Judah. And I think God wants to speak something to us through these two pictures, okay? Now, it says in Revelation 5 verse 6, the Lamb of God was slain. I saw a lamb looking as if it had been slain. And of course, that's what happened to Jesus on the cross. On the cross, Jesus was the Lamb of God who was slain for our sins. Okay. At the same time, it says, the Lion of the tribe of Judah has triumphed. So the Lamb of God is a picture of someone slain. The Lion of Judah is a triumphant picture. They're the same person. Okay. You might say that the Lamb of God is an image of humility. Okay. Isaiah 53 verse 7 says he was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. That picture of humility, of lowliness, of becoming nothing, and allowing himself to be crucified, completely innocent, but for our sins. And at the same time, the Lion of Judah is a picture or the image of authority. And this is taken all the way in Genesis, when Jacob is blessing his 12 sons and prophesying over them. And his prophecy over Judah includes this: you are a lion's cub, O Judah. And later the scepter, which means of rulership, of authority, will not depart from Judah. And of course, Jesus was from the tribe of Judah, the root of David. David also was, of course, from the tribe of Judah. And therefore, not only is the Lion of Judah triumphant, but his authority is eternal, is forever. So we have these two pictures. And the point is this. I mean, at this moment, both pictures look really nice. And you might prefer the Lion of Judah. You might prefer relating to the Lion of Judah than the Lamb of God. The Lamb of God slain, humble. Yes, it's nice, but wow. I like this picture of the Lion of Judah, triumphant with eternal and everlasting and complete authority, actually. Okay. There are some implications of relating to the Lamb and relating to the Lion. As we look at Jesus, often we relate to one or the other picture. Okay. I want to look at two verses here. In 1 Peter 2 verses 2 to 3, it says, that like newborn babies crave pure spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation now that you have tasted that the Lord is good. And I get that sense of nurture. And you know, when we come to Jesus, just like the rich young man came, we come to him as Savior. We come to him with our problems. We come to him in our fallenness and sometimes complete utter hopelessness. And even that picture of being born again is, of course, being born as a spiritual baby, not as someone mature. Okay. On the other hand, in Hebrews, you can sense a kind of impatience, the writer of Hebrews talking to his readers. And he says, anyone who lives on milk is not acquainted with the teaching about righteousness, but solid food is for the mature, who by constant use have trained themselves to distinguish good from evil. And he said that you all guys should be mature by now, but you all are still babies. That is the context there. And that sense of discipline that comes from the Lion, as opposed to just nurture that comes from the Lamb of God. I want to unpack this a little bit further. Okay, so you have the Lamb of God nurture, and that passage like newborn babies. You have the Lion of Judah, what I call discipline. Anyone who lives on milk is not acquainted, and so on and so forth. Okay. So the Lamb of God, if you're relating to the Lamb of God more, your focus is that, you know, what is it saying there? You're a newborn baby, there's nothing wrong with that. Okay. But the Lion is saying you've got to become mature. You can't just remain newborn babies. Okay. You're having milk, but you have to at some point move to solid food. Okay. The baby is just growing up. It's a natural process. The baby literally does nothing to grow up, just grows up naturally. But when you are heading for maturity, there's training. Training is deliberate. Training is often unpleasant and uncomfortable, but you choose to do it. Okay? That's the aspect of nurture. You're growing up in your salvation, that experience of salvation, of freedom from the things that were binding you. But when it's about discipline, when it's about the Lion and relating to him, it's about righteousness. Righteousness is being right with God. And of course, you have tasted that the Lord is good. You're enjoying God. But at some point, you have to move from enjoying God to pleasing God. You know, the mature, having solid food by constant use, training themselves, distinguish good from evil, so that you choose what is good and that pleases God. You know, babies get away with so much nonsense, no? But as you grow up, you can't get away with that. You've got to discern or distinguish good from evil, right from wrong. And that is what is pleasing to God. And I guess the point I'm trying to make is that we're really happy to relate to the Lamb. That's what that rich young ruler came. He came to the Lamb. And he had been, and the sad thing is, a lot of us are stuck over here. We're happy being babies, spiritual babies, having milk. It's spiritual milk. It's pure spiritual milk. And at some point, you have to crave it. It's not that, I'm not saying that that's not a good thing. There may be some today in the service, some who hear this message, who actually need to become babies, who need to be born again, who need to come to the Lamb. So I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I'm speaking to those who've been newborn babies for too long now, who've been happy with milk. And the writer of Hebrews is saying exactly that, you chaps are still stuck on milk. Why are you still having milk? Okay. Because at some point, God challenges us. He says, I am the Lamb, yes, who takes away the sin of the world, who chose to become nothing upon the cross. But I am also the Lion of Judah. And I'm offering you solid food. I'm calling you into maturity. You have to decide. You have to choose to undergo training. Your priority has to be not pleasing yourself or enjoying God, so much of what we do in Highway is about intimacy, which is about enjoying God. But at the same time, there has to be this importance that our priority is pleasing God. Suppose I come into a worship service and I don't like any of the songs. I didn't enjoy the worship. But suppose I pleased God with my worship. What is more important? See, that's when you realize it's about the Lion. It's not just about the Lamb. Okay, and I'm not belittling the Lamb. There could not have been the Lion without the Lamb. Please understand that. You know, the Lamb, God, Jesus became the Lamb of God. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place. Therefore, he has authority because he chose to become the Lamb of God for you and me. And therefore, he has all authority. He is now the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He's in actually both together. As I said, John is told by the elder, look, the Lion of the tribe of Judah. And he looks and he sees the Lamb of God. The elder says, look, the Lion of the tribe of Judah is worthy to open the scrolls and read it. And you know, the next chapters, it is the Lamb who opens the scrolls and reads them, because they're the same person. Okay. It's just that we end up with one image and we forget about the other image. But as we go to maturity, the Lion has to be terribly important. As I said, this is a very short message because the words teach themselves. Okay. The Lamb offers, but the Lion requires. You know, and you might say there's a catch here, therefore. Actually, there is no catch. You can actually take the offering and lead a substandard Christian life without doing what the Lion requires. Okay, the Lamb offers salvation. The Lamb offers heaven, of course. Okay, salvation, for example, salvation is found in no other name but the name of Jesus. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord, which means Jesus, will be saved. Of course, he offers us in heaven. He says that all who believed in him got eternal life. And Jesus said, I came to bring life and life in all of its abundance. And so we come to the Lamb, we come to the cross, we come to what Jesus did for us on the cross. We accept his sacrifice on our behalf. We accept that he paid the penalty for our sins. We receive his salvation. We are certain, we are confident that our destination is heaven. We start living this wonderful life. But at the same time, the Lamb who is the Lion requires this. Yes, he offers salvation. He requires surrender. He offers heaven. He requires our hearts. He offers life. But then he says, I want to be the Lord of that life. And often I find that we are happy with what the lamb offers, but we are of course struggling with what the lion requires. And if you remember, so often I just keep coming back to that phrase that we heard in Alpha, saved soul, wasted life. And you might be saved. You might have come to the lamb, but if you don't come to the lion as well, if you don't surrender your heart and accept his lordship, you're going to have a wasted life. It's going to be so sad that you would not partner with Jesus in what he wanted you to do on this earth. Let me go to my last slide. Okay. So relating to the Lamb, we cry out Savior, because of the Lamb of God, of course, saves us from our sins and we become believers. At one point, there was this big thing. Are you a believer? Are you a believer? People would keep on going because you had the nominal, you had traditional churches, Christians and members, and we were constantly asked, are you a believer? Okay. But in fact, Jesus is not looking for believers. Okay. As we relate to the Lion of Judah, we cry out, Lord, and we become disciples. And Jesus said, make disciples of all nations. He's looking for disciples. And I think the challenge here is this, is that as we continue in the Christian life, and also I think especially as we are focusing so much on worship and on intimacy and on enjoying God, we can just get stuck over there. Okay? Or in our prayers, we can just keep focusing on what will make our lives comfortable. But the Lamb of God is also the Lion of Judah. And he says, I want your surrender. I want your heart. I want lordship over your life. I want disciples who are willing to be trained, who are willing to pay the price, who are willing to labor. And I really think in this season, even as we are enjoying God more and more and more and more, and even as we are asking for more and more of him, he says, I want complete lordship. You've all come to the Lamb. Will you not also surrender to the Lion? You know, let's not be like the rich ruler or this rich young man. He was very happy to receive the Lamb, but he walked away from the Lion. And we don't want to be in that position. I want to say two prayers today. I want to firstly just pray for, I think I can stop share this. You know, I just want to first say that if there's anybody here who hasn't come to the Lamb even, who hasn't received that offer of salvation, who's not confident of your destination being heaven. But even now the Lamb invites you into that relationship, into that freedom from your sins and bondages. The Lamb of God invites you into belief, into faith, into an intimate relationship with him. And if you don't have that, even now you can say yes to him. But I think there are many more here who have said yes to the Lamb, but are struggling with the Lion. So I pray, Holy Spirit, that today you will enable us to respond to this challenge. To say yes to the lion. I pray today, Lord, there may be surrender of hearts to your Lordship. I pray this morning, Lord, that many will go from being just believers to becoming disciples. From only enjoying you to choosing to please you. That today, Lord, we may welcome your discipline and your training. We may desire to move into maturity. Just as the beaver says in one of the Narnia books, the lion is not tame, but he is good, for he is so good. We thank you, Lord Jesus, Lamb of God, for all that you did for us. And we thank you that that love and that goodness, the perfection of your plans continues as you speak to us as the Lion of the tribe of Judah. Invite us into your holiness, into the awesome purposes you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. I just want to give opportunity for those who would like to respond in prayer, or even with a spoken word, somebody can read what Mayor has written, but also others who would like to just respond in prayer to this word today, not to what I have said really, but to the words that you've heard from scripture especially. And if you'd like to respond in prayer, please go ahead. I'll just mute myself for a while.
Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for every way in which you have nourished me, nurtured me. In every way, Lord, you have quietened me, Lord. Your tenderness and your gentleness, Lord, that has healed me and restored me and made me whole again, Lord. And today, Lord, I really ask Holy Spirit, that really you lead me into that place from being a believer, Lord, to really being a disciple, Lord. Just want to surrender my heart, my life, all that I have, Lord, to be able to choose you, Lord. Every single day, Lord. To please you, Lord, to delight you, Lord. To come alongside you, Lord, to walk with you and talk with you, Lord. And to share your heart and burden, Lord. Just want that to be, Lord, the call and purpose of my life. Thank you, Jesus. And thank you for this word, Lord. Deeply moving and convicting word, Lord. Thank you. In your precious name, Lord. I pray. Amen.
Just struck me that listening to Uday's words and the messages embedded, I don't know if I'm right, but I saw a distinction between believer and disciples in this way in my life, that being a believer is free. It comes with little or no strings attached. But true discipleship comes at a cost. And that cost is complete surrender to Jesus. And I think when we go on to that path of discipleship, it really challenges or us or me to ask myself if I am truly willing to pay that price. So I think that's the meditation that I will take away and continue to reflect on today.
And Jesus, we just want to thank you, Lord, that even though, Lord, we would prefer to be with the Lamb, Lord, you challenge us, Lord, to come alongside you, who are the Lion, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that if we just remained as with the Lamb, Lord, we would never grow, Lord, in you, Lord. We would never experience you as you really are, Lord. We would never be in an intimate relationship with you, Lord. So we just want to thank you, Lord, for calling us, Lord, to just recognize you as the Lion of Judah, the Lion, Lord, who challenges us, who stands alongside us, who encourages us, Lord, who grows us up, Lord, in our from babies, Lord, in the word, Lord, to someone, Lord, who really comes alongside you, hears you, listens to you, Lord, and prays according to your will, Lord. I pray, Lord, for this church, Lord, for each and every member of this church, Lord, to just, Lord, be challenged to even as, Lord, everyone faces difficulties and trials in life, Lord, we pray, Lord, that we will be able to surrender, Lord, to the Lion who is you, Lord Jesus, and that really, Father, that we will come closer to you, Lord, learn more of you, Lord, draw closer to you, Lord, walk intimately with you, Lord, because, Lord, that is what you desire, Lord, to be in an intimate relationship with us, Lord. So we pray, Lord, that really, Father, that we will just open up our hearts, our ears, our eyes, everything, Lord, to you, so that, Lord, we will really know you, love you, come close to you, our Heavenly Father. This ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord Jesus, we just want to thank you that you discipline the ones you love, and you are calling us to so much more. Lord, we just want to confess and say sorry for just remaining in a place of stagnancy. But Lord, today, this morning, even as your word is impressed on our hearts, we want to sign up for the next step, the next level. That place of being effective for you, Lord God, that place of letting go of the things that are easy and comfortable and really signing up for the training that you want to give me and each and every one of us here, Lord. Because we know that we are also called to so much more and not just cruising through life in a place of receiving, but really we've received so much all these years. You have poured out so much, Lord, your spirit, your wisdom. And Lord, we just want to be a place of openness, to be led by you into all that you want us to do, to move in boldness and courage, and to truly pour out all that you have poured into us, Lord God, and to be effective in blessing the world around us with the help of your Spirit. And even as I was thinking about this, I just remember this picture of from Narnia, of this little girl sitting on Aslan's back, and as he runs through
the forest. Lord God, we know that you are with us, you go before us, and we just want to be in that place of trusting you and being used by you for your glory, for your honor, and your fame. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Jesus, we thank you for this fresh invitation today, Lord, to come and follow you, Lord, wherever you lead us. And Lord, we thank you that even as your word records for us, Lord, your yoke is easy, your burden is light, Lord. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're such a good teacher. You're so patient and so gentle, Lord. And according to your power at work in us, Lord God, you are calling us, Lord God, to train us up in works of righteousness, equipping us, Lord, to be those, like Renelle prayed, effective disciples for you, Lord. Lord, I want to say yes to you this morning, Jesus. Thank you, like Uday reminded us, that you are the lion of the tribe of Judah, but you are a good lion.
Yes, Jesus.
And you have given us your name, your power, and your authority, Lord. Thank you for this fresh invitation into discipleship. Thank you that there's no need to be overwhelmed, that where you call us, you go before us. You are with us, Lord, every step of the way. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Go ahead.
Yeah, so as we heard the message and everybody's been praying, just thought of this passage from John 21 after his resurrection, when Jesus appears to Peter. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said, "you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." The third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." So we just want to thank you, Father, that even as we respond, Lord, to this invitation, Lord, to surrender to you afresh, the Lion of Judah, Lord, you are calling us, Lord, to demonstrate and show you, Lord, our love by feeding your lambs. Just want to ask, Lord, for your grace to be faithful, Lord, to live our lives wholly for you, for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Just going to read what Meher has written. "The Lion and the Lamb. Sometimes I wonder how a lion can be like a lamb, and how does a lamb become a lion? One is so meek and seemingly weak, the other majestic and oh so strong. The lamb can be cuddled and makes you feel safe. The lion challenges you with his majesty and grace. The lamb brings comfort and treats you like a child. The lion says, grow up and lead a holy life. The lion challenges you to stand strong in your faith. Life brings challenges, but with the lion at your side, you need not fear, for he is strong. He will shelter you when you face storms. He will go ahead to fight your battles and bring you through to sing his praise. And then you will experience joy in your storm
as you experience the Lord, who is the Lion and the Lamb. And Misha says, Jesus, the Lion of Judah, chose to become the Lamb for our salvation. May we never be so caught up in the comfort of salvation that we take for granted his grace. He is the Lion, the Lord of Lords, and worthy of not just our love, but our complete reverence and surrender.
Thank you.
And Sujata says on Facebook, thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are both the lamb and the lion, drawing us with love, compassion, and understanding as the lamb. You desire that you grow us into maturity, that we'd be strengthened to go out to be your disciples, strong and under your lordship, laboring for your kingdom. I surrender to your lordship. Amen. And Misha says, let us cast off our man-made crowns and bow before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the name above all names, the one whom the Father has given authority over all things.
I waited for the Lord. He turned and heard my cry. His mercy opened up my eyes when I couldn't see. My strength was failing. I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah. I heard the voice that calmed the raging sea. He came to me when I needed the Lord. I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah. Darkest night, when I couldn't see, and my strength was failing me, I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah. I heard the voice that calmed the raging sea. He came to me. Came to me when I needed the Lord. I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah. I lifted my hands, he lifted me out. All praise to the Savior, all worship to God. With all of the Lion of Judah, I heard the voice that calms the raging sea. He came to me when I needed the Lord. I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah. He came to me when I needed the Lord. I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah. I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah. I heard the roar of the Lion of Judah.
And in some ways, this roar is a call to arms, a call to battle. That call to surrender and discipleship, to spiritual warfare, to stepping out of the boat and into the water. I pray, Holy Spirit, for you are the one who gives us the power to be your witnesses. You are the one who gives us boldness. You are the one who gives us wings. You are the one who puts words in our mouths. You are the one who, through whom the gospel is confirmed with signs and wonders. I pray, Holy Spirit, fill us afresh this morning. We ask for more of you. Fresh anointing to fulfill your mandate upon our lives, this great commission, this incredible partnership in the work of your kingdom. We can't do it without you, Holy Spirit. We pray, fill us afresh this morning. Let the rivers of living water flow. And bless a nation that is so thirsty for you. Bless the people around us. Who are desperate, don't even know for what. We just say more of you. More of you, Holy Spirit.
He's roaring the power and fighting our battles.
can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty?
Lord Jesus, thank you that the answer to that question is no one and nothing can stop the Lord Almighty. Today, Lord, as we end this beautiful time of being in your presence and of learning more of you and your nature, we just want to thank you that truly you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We ask today that as we leave this place, Lord, we will submit more fully to your Lordship, to the discipleship that you want to engage us in.
Yes, Jesus.
So we just give you praise now, Lord, that you don't allow us to remain infants, that you grow us, and you grow us in so many different ways, Lord. And so we just ask tonight, Lord, that we may submit to that process of growth willingly and joyfully, and that we may grow into those warriors, Lord, that you need, particularly at this time of the world when there's so much evil run rampant and there are so many needs, Lord. I pray that you will raise each one of us up to be your warrior disciples who will fight for you against the forces of evil that we see all around us. We just thank you for your protection. We thank you, Lord, really just for your vast and amazing love for us. And Lord, we just commit ourselves again today to being your disciples. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.